All right.
I'll edit it later.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. See some beautiful faces out here? Welcome. So, on behalf of the Drum Orpheum, my name is Dan Kelly II, and I am the proud owner and founder of this fine establishment, which we are the Winchester's first and only artistic hub for everyone in the arts and entertainment district. So, you'll be hearing a lot of poets tonight, a lot of music tonight that will set you to the edge of your seat on purpose. Because this show is not like your ordinary show. Not like this show that you go to a regular concert at Jiffy Lube Live, one day. But it's a interactive show, meaning that if the vibe makes you feel joyful, if the vibe makes you feel expressive, and something that the poet or the musician has done or said, you can snap, you can clap. If a holler or a yell is like, yeah, comes out, go ahead. Because this is an open space, you know? And the whole event is called In the Round, a Jazz Poetry Experience, where we combine the spoken word with jazz vibes to push you into a huge and smooth atmosphere. Poets that you will hear tonight will be none other than Joseph Jablonski, Wayne David Hubbard, and Sean Murphy, with guitarist Andrew Renner, and yours truly on drum set. So, without further ado, one thing. After the last poet spoken, everyone's going to take a bow, and then you can have this opportunity to meet them and greet them, get signed autographs, signed books, in the lobby after the show. Sounds good? Good?
Yes.
Nice. If it sounds good, can everyone snap? If it sounds good, can everyone clap? Now you guys are ready. So, without further ado, the In the Round experience.
Thank you.
or the light beaming from the far side of the sun? Where does it end, or where do we begin? You had chosen to believe in life, in love, and a God no one had seen. In tomorrow, in dreams, perhaps even in me. I believe in you. As real to me as that one time we stood atop a canyon called Universe, your face illumined from the flare of a trillion stars. When I scanned the void for our sun's familiar glint, you touched my arm that pointed beyond, as if to say, we're out there, somewhere, I think. Thank you.
rehearsal for the big one. A way for the plastic universe to conjure consciousness from circuits. Solution, says life of coach. Affirmation set in Gucci vibes, posted far and wide. Maybe tie me with Ethernet to the bed. Not all that bad.
Talent or or industry, or worse still, a kind of honesty incomprehensible to those fluent in spreadsheets and portfolios measuring moral trash swept out to sea the second the check clears. Antimatter, dead on arrival, living off the good deeds of those not built to thrive in this morose arena where soul isn't material. Wealth's measured by the weight of wallets and cars driven at the highest speeds to nowhere. Third, imagine jazz as a landscape you can't capture with a camera, but it's also nothing like that. Rahsaan Roland Kirk talked about brain moments, those sacred occasions, sometimes lasting only seconds, where one feels deeply connected to the music, the message, the soul of the messenger. Booker Little, only 23 and already being stalked like easy prey by everything unfair about fate, named his final album Victory and Sorrow, a declaration of defiance as he died like an abandoned Gabriel, his horn signaling revelation even while the world crumbled around him. Ornette Coleman insisted there was something else, and then spent several decades offering clues to satisfy unsoothed minds. Let my children hear music, the mighty Charles Mingus hollered, like Moses holding up his stone tablets, already aware there was better money to be made elsewhere, the ears of this world always itching for easier sources of amusement. Perhaps it will suffice then to suggest that jazz is music, is finally an escutcheon, a spiritual shield for those seeking protection from false prophets. Art is best understood as a succession of prayers already answered, their source a faith that requires no ceremony, and is both shared.
Everything begins with inhale and exhale and never ends. Moment after moment, inhaling and exhaling. Singing, hearing, smelling, touching, tasting, moving, walking, sleeping, day after day and year after year, until it is now, this moment, the moment of your being. But who says these things? I wrote my life, my past through introspection. I killed the god of my youth, upended his scale with so simple a question and innocent pondering. How can love reject itself? The death of all deaths, you only die once, they told me. But then they say to die before you die, or rather be twice born, and this being much too much, all I wanted was to sleep. And now come the dreams, where, like then, I am outside of time or fear. Beyond pleasure and pain, worry and regret. I see, smell, taste, touch, hear, and move in this world without cause for explanation. So vivid and pure the motions therein, I can no longer tell which is falling asleep or waking up.
at open door boutiques. I diligently drown my classism in open container reveries. But still, I let everyone swill, share in the forum, where y'all often don't say much at all. Even so, I live for your idle chat. Prefer the eccentric with his clack clack than the priest quack with his hellfire attack. I hum awkwardly to his arguments, high in the strum of songwriter's string, until he leaves and joy makes his return. Here, even the ghosts are dancing, Washington orating the farewell we forgot, surveying our lot. He's heard best by the splash pad children soaking the innocence of summer. Those small ears thankfully don't hear my past's cruel voice. Tremors and terrors before I was a choice. Your red and blue patriotic fade to blue and gray conflict and nightmare. Oh, I try to forget the 77 ways I was claimed. My dreams fright like the guy at midnight rang the metal pipe. Stern voices, hoofbeats, pleas of courtyard corral prisoners. Shouts and glass, crystal frosting scattering from storms. And then I awake, safely again in the estate for play in the midst of first Fridays. But I digress. What was it you wanted to discuss again? Was it the way I cradle the hideaway in the quiet unstep south? Or the secret gardens tucked behind both espresso and American bars? Or the hidden tunnels that cross underground? Am I in marketplace? Or parading ground. There aren't many real towns left in America like me. So I insist, carve your children's chalk on my clay canvas. Write your poems, pass your plates, let your voices roam. For with me, all are free to speak dreams. And your replies to mine are warm and sweet. They are a chorus of society, right on the left of the street.
Thank you.
poised for sustained success, Monk was instead derailed by mental illness and largely disappeared from the scene by the late 60s. This is the loneliest Monk's moment. It was finally happening. Monk had arrived. Jazz has arrived. And not their father's shit, but a wholly singular form of expression. Carried, of course, through the 20th century on the broad black shores that hustled their weapons of choice in and out of clubs, grimed with sweat and the smell of smoke, the filthy, delicious shockwaves of money and applause, every concert a new chemistry being conducted live after working hours. All these elements substantiating eternity. Here, at last, the underground given voice, not requiring words, but speaking to things America is never really prepared to hear. We shall overcome by any means necessary, etc. White folks marching. It was finally time for this country to discover itself, renaming certain spaces from the inside out. A hard art that meets you on your own terms, wherever you are, and whatever you choose to believe, like music always does. And then it was over. Britain invaded again. Waves launching a million ships, bringing 45s and the flattery of imitation. A perfect recipe some master chef had tinkered with in the kitchen. Adding some blues here, some country there, seasoned always with the sweat of slaves. That ingredient screaming, made in the USA. Through the graded curve of history, hindsight helps ugly beauty seem inevitable. You can't make soup without preparing the stock. You need to let those bones soak, and eventually, as the broth simmers ceaselessly on the back burner, even success seems conceivable. And on the lower frequencies, busboys and poets continue cleaning plates, pocketing spare change, and scarfing down whatever the cooks serve up. Hot meals hastily savored, straight, no chaser. Then a quick mirror check for the teeth, and back out to the dining room, where folks who keep the lights on order aperitifs and inquire about today's specials. Thank you.
white teens giggle as one at secret jokes. A family of three in bright tourist t-shirts exchange nervous glances. Two Asian women hunch close to each other over a single cell phone screen. One European lady, crumpled a dress, Liz Taylor eyelashes, pouts openly, visibly bored. 59th Street Station, Columbus Circle. An intercom voice announces an indefinite delay due to unknown maintenance issues. A multi-chorus drone fills the train cabin. Doors open, people flee. But not the woman who begins her speech on her secrets to a better world. I stay.
Ancestry lived we forget that death is an analog power. Perhaps this is the dream of all the neon in Vegas. To pray with electricity, drown the stars with circuitry. Paint a new pixel ceiling, Sistine light blinding our dark twisted fantasies in the rest.
Thank you.
crisis and a little more of energy behind it. So this poem, which is called Disco's Last Dance, tries to address that, and it's inspired by an actual event that occurred on July 12th, 1979. At Chicago's Comiskey Park, they had disco demolition night, and it deteriorated into a near riot after 98 set tickets were sold, and anyone with a disco record to destroy could get in for 98 cents. So it drew an overflow crowd, some of whom fed on cheap beer, stormed the field, causing the game to be canceled. So this is about that night, and it's called Disco's Last Dance. Death before disco, some of us said. Others, opportunistic, or at least disc jockeys, wore on t-shirts. Their sentiment as sincere as their lives weren't. In fairness, backlash after ubiquity is the American way. We root for you until we decide you have enough of whatever you've been given, be it fame, fortune, free love, or the whole unholy trinity. Also, disco was the soundtrack to whatever was happening at Studio 54, that wasp's nest of iniquity, where unapproachable people went to be seen doing things most of us never do. Mick Jagger and other jagoffs waiting in the wings, full wallets muffling their falls on feverish Saturday nights. Envious and out of other options, we decided to despise them. Oh, and this musical style managed to be at once too black and too gay, making it that much easier to misunderstand and malign. But how many of us were hazily aware of a familiar undercurrent resurfacing throughout the 20th century like a contagious disease that involved certain cultures and the imperative to stymie them? How many of us failed to grasp we were being fed a narrative almost too easy to swallow? All artificial and fattening, like our devotion to Hamburger Helper and Shake and Bake, which epitomized, we thought, our mother's culinary game. We didn't realize how our new selves sported a toupee, blissfully oblivious to what this signified, and the greedy ways some men grasp at shortcuts to stay relevant way past their shelf lives. Or what Donna Summers really meant when she sang about feeling love, not to mention what the word love alludes to in pretty much all pop songs. Or that the village people, no matter what costumes they put on, were clearly playing for the wrong team. Did disco balls burn too brightly, leaving the dance lines on Soul Train blinded by their light? So many sweaty deities in leisure suits. Did Walter Cronkite fail to warn us? That's the way it is as a decade died down. And crazy from the summer heat, or simply looking for an excuse, the geniuses running the White Sox, because of course, had an idea. Get a bunch of drunk guys in one spot and give them a target. We applauded the televised transmission of salty earthlings flipping 45s onto the field, winning one for the Dipper and clearing a safe space for synthesizers and drum machines. Like so many soldiers of misfortune, these macho men reclaimed the soul of a nation according to the gospel of beer-fueled dumpster fires. Look again at this unpoliced lineup and notice history pointing in either direction. Can you see hidden men in hoods rallying around a tree from a photo op? Or a trucker's cap crashing onto a lunch counter? Or a cop dropping his baton on another colored crime in progress? enraptured folks in red hats receiving marching orders from another old man, unembarrassable with his specious hair and oversized suit, who once blew rails in Big Apple bathrooms, a veteran of the disco days, doing the YMCA on stage without irony, promising to provide everything God, spinning vinyl in the VIP section, hasn't quite gotten around to delivering.
Decides who goes ahead and who stays.
unspoken dreams of passerby wave into melodies. I try to stick to brass tacks as brass straps attack harmonies, drumming heartbeats, vibraphone tone, the sweet answer to the pessimism creeping in. I return to earth and listen. See, touch, taste, and feel the sixth sense making an entrance when my fingers pause. I get lost in the sauce. I think I am living. Close eyes, just listening. I am salivating to hear a real sound. The real thing under all our battle. The essence of the York side.
Thank you.
something obviously was working. I was prescient for just plain lucky enough to sign up for an elective called Introduction to Jazz. We'd gone through a century, decade by decade, and it got better as we went. Yes, bebop was what I've been missing all along without realizing it. But it was what came next, the more formless expression that started creeping out of the margins, like lava oozing through ancient stones, that portended obsession. Those names, Mingus, Monk, Miles. And then, as we tackled the topic of free jazz, a dissident with the audacity to name an album The Shape of Jazz to Come, Ornette Coleman, the canary in the post-bop coal mine. Like all iconoclasts, initially greeted with indifference, then disgust, then fear. His compositions scoffed at convention, freak flags flying out of the underground into the avant-garde. I still remember how quiet the room was and how concerned my ears got. What is this? Like something I'd never heard or felt. A new language, a new sensation, a new way of seeing everything. That first amoeba slithering onto shore. Nothing I'd ever known in all the things I now knew I needed. How is it possible, I thought, to make instruments scream in agony and shriek in joy at the same time? I walked around campus after, the autumn sky all schizophrenic, yet serene with colors. And those notes I couldn't get out of my head. This is it, I thought. This is music. This is addiction. This is love. This is the first day of the rest of my life.
Song on the radio.
waiting for the rest of the class to figure it out. Love feels real and unreal as one. Love is like a shooting star. Love is not like a shooting star. Love is like a tumbling bullet. Love is not at all like a bullet. Love feels like home. Love feels like home is home. Love feels like never having to be alone again, even if for a moment you are alone. Love is like a juggernaut. Love is not like a juggernaut. It feels like what you, it feels like liking what you see in a mirror. It feels like knowing how lucky you are, knowing that you need never complain again. Love feels like uncongealed life. It feels like electricity flowing into your skin from a source outside your skin, reaching places in your body you forget were there. A love once had a name. A love once forgot its name, falling through a quicksand of bliss. A love once would have murdered, but in the last instant, chose life. A love kept you alive long enough to be with me. A love kept me alive long enough to feel the love that was present the entire time and also to love you. It feels like nakedness brushed by open air. It feels like that thing. Love feels like that thing. You know what I mean.
Just be one reason. That's it. Have a good night, guys.